Joining us from Capitol Hill this morning is Representative Jack Kingston, opponent of the legislation. Sir, walk us through why you oppose this legislation.
Well, if you think about what we're trying to do is put people to work, and of an $825 billion package, only 7% actually goes to these shovel-ready projects. 7% in the year 2009, that's not an immediate fix to the economy. I think we could do a lot better job on it. Of the $325 billion in the spending portion, $50 billion goes to the National Endowment for the Arts. It doesn't create jobs. Now, we were able to get the millions of dollars for contraceptives out, and the resodding of the National Mall came out of it, but we still have the $3 billion for a wellness program in there. There's a lot of money in here that should just go through the regular appropriations process instead of being pushed out in the name of stimulus. And so I think we can do a lot better job. This is not a big job creation package. In fact, if you do the math and use the president's number of 3.7 million jobs that this will create or save, and save is a very nebulous term, as you know, but that's about $250,000 per job. The average American household income is $50,000, so you know that's disproportionate. We're not getting the bang for the buck. The money that we're spending, we're not getting the jobs out of it that we should, Greta.
But Congressman Mark Zandi of Economy.com and an advisor to Republican presidential candidate John McCain is quoted in the paper this morning saying that the portions of the stimulus package will infiltrate the economy quickly are the additional unemployment benefits, the health insurance, food stamps, and student loans for low-income Americans, along with most of the tax cuts for individuals and businesses. And he calls it a big bang for the buck. And our previous guest, Congresswoman Karen Maloney, cited 145, some of them conservative economists that support this legislation.
Well, you know, Greta, that's interesting because I've been a member of Congress for 16 years. We had actually one hearing in the Appropriations Committee on our portion of the bill. One hearing. Mr. Zandi was not there. By the way, he also supports liberal Congressman Joe Zesnick from Pennsylvania, who's a liberal Democrat, as you know. So he's not exactly he's a political kind of economist, if you will. But I've never heard of Zandi. Probably most of your listeners have never heard of Mr. Zandi, but suddenly he's being paraded out as the standard for the Democrats. I would have loved to have hearings where we could have talked to any one of these alleged 140 economists and talked to them about it. Because, Greta, if deficit spending worked, and keep in mind we have a $10.6 trillion national debt right now, $10.6 trillion. If deficit spending worked, why didn't the $168 billion that we spent on a stimulus package in May turn the economy around, or the $200 billion that we spent for Fannie Mae bailout, or the $700 billion for the Wall Street bailout, or the $25 billion for AIG in $29 billion for Bear Stearns in March and $85 billion for AIG in September. We just spent $1 trillion on bailout and stimulus just in 2008, and Greta, it didn't turn the economy around. So what we're doing now is saying, oh, I know, we'll just keep running that same play and over again until we get it right. I think a far better way to handle this would have been targeted tax relief to small businesses where 70% of the jobs in our economy are created, and do what Mr. Obama said and in his inaugural address, reward risk takers and the entrepreneurs.
Under what conditions would you vote for this legislation?
Well, I think that the spending really needs to be targeted to public works, roads, bridges, dams, building renovation, things like that. Instead of just 7% that would be spent in 2009, bump that number up to at least 50%. Because we want to get those shovel-ready projects online. But again, only 7% shovel-ready right now. That would be step one. Step two would be, I think, an across-the-board tax would cut. You could go from, if you're in the 10% bracket, to 5%, 15% bracket, down to 10%, and down the line like that. That would help middle-class families put money in their pockets and help them through this tough economic time. Another thing you could do is actually take the tax off of unemployment benefits, because right now if you are laid off and you receive unemployment, we actually turn around and tax you on your unemployment benefits, knowing that you don't have a job. That's why you're getting the benefits. That's absurd. That's something that we could do. Expanding small business expensing, that could help small businesses create new jobs. Another thing for our cities and counties, and I spoke on Monday to the Georgia Municipal Association, which is represents probably about 750 mayors and city councilmen across the state of Georgia, is get some of the unfunded mandates that we as a federal government thrust upon cities and towns, which cause them to have to spend money and tax their own people for it. But I think we could roll back some of those things.
President Obama yesterday at his news conference up on Capitol Hill said there are legitimate philosophical differences between Democrats and Republicans, but he also said that some are playing politics. How do you respond to that?
Well, I can say this. We had a great meeting with President Obama. We reached out to him. He reached out to us. We need bipartisan cooperation in Washington, D.C., just like they do in every city council chamber across America. You keep your principal differences, you allow for philosophical differences, and yet you come together for what's good for the town or city, and in this case, the entire nation, and I think we can do that. I think that there's going to always be some on the hard right or hard left who want to play to the gallery, and they want to, you know, maybe make themselves look good by making the institution look bad, but I think at this point, we all want to come together. Now, unfortunately, in that meeting with President Obama, Speaker Pelosi did not attend. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if she today called Republican leader John Boehner and said, hey, you know, Mr. Obama met with y'all yesterday. I want to meet with you today, and I want to invite you to meet with our Democrats, and why don't we set up some bipartisan subgroups, and we could do things, for example, have hearings on the stimulus bill, which we have not had, and we could have some more real dialogue and real cross-examination of the economists, of the experts, and we could come together, and at the end of the day, you'd have a package that might have one-third Democrat philosophy, one-third Republican philosophy, but one-third middle ground compromise, and the total package would be reflective of America's needs, and it would turn the economy around. And to me, that would be a very great approach to solving this problem.
Jack Kingstein is with us this morning until the bottom of the hour. He represents Georgia's first district. Good morning.
I'm in agreement with Mr. Kingston. I don't think the stimulus package is going to do us much good at all. I'm retired. We make less than $45,000 a year. And $1,000 credit is less than $100 a month in my pocket. My cost with the increases that have come are well over $100 a month. So I'm not gaining anything. And I can't book myself a raise. And I can't tax somebody for more income. And my other point that I would like to make is that if my kids are in trouble, and I'm in trouble, I can't loan them money. I've got to take care of myself first, or I'll never be able to help them down the road. And I feel the same way about our money that we're spending overseas, my money, to all these countries, and half of them don't like us anyway.
All right, Congressman?
Well, you know, it's an interesting point. Right now, we actually borrow a lot of money from overseas as well. We owe foreign governments about $3 trillion, and we owe China, for example, over $600 billion. It's 22% of our foreign debt we owe to China, and followed by Japan and Great Britain. So we got a problem there, and the caller had mentioned his children. I think one of the great travesties of this is we're actually breaking into our children and your grandchildren's piggy banks, and we're borrowing this money from them. The interest alone, according to the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office, the interest on this is going to be $347 billion. So it's actually a $1 trillion package when you put the interest in it in terms of what we're going to be borrowing to pay for this thing. And so we are digging a hole that's very, very deep, but unfortunately our children are the ones who are going to have to pay for it.
Middletown, Ohio, Republican line.
Hi, my name is Laura, and I'm working two jobs. Don't have much time to do anything else, but I have had a little time to watch C-SPAN. And I'm very unhappy with the way our leaders and people who vote in are working together. It just made me sick the way the Democrats, every time the Republicans filed an amendment, it was immediately voted down, every one of them right in a row, and finally the one didn't even read his.
Are you talking about, Middleton, are you talking about coverage of the Rules Committee?
When they were trying to make amendments to the, the economic package, they were trying to make changes.
Right,
to that,
right.
You know?
Okay.
And I don't know too much about all the terminology with this, but I was really upset about the way they won't work together. And I loved Mr. I think Kingsman, whoever you have there, him talking about one third Democrat, maybe their ideas, one third Republican, one third maybe bipartisan. I think that sounds wonderful. But I think our main problem with this country, of course, this doesn't have nothing right with this bill, but we have become non-productive. We do not promote production in this country. We have so much abuse with the money that's already given out. I'd like to know how much we already give to everybody. And I'm very unhappy that we have so many people getting money already from the government. And if we even get more money, there's going to be more people collecting. And I know people that work on the side that, make it unemployment, but then they're also working on the side, getting cash, doing other things.
Middleton, let me jump in here. You said you have two jobs with many people not being able to find a job. What two jobs do you have?
I substitute teach, and I work at McDonald's. Okay, it's under $20,000 a year. Okay, that's not, and I have no health insurance.
Okay. Congressman, what about that caller? What she had to say?
Well, I think she said a lot, and maybe one of the things that I heard is that she wants to see results. She wants to see a government that works and policies that make sense and bring results. And I think one of the concerns that we all have is that are we rewarding city and county, state governments for bad behavior and people individually for not producing? And one of the things and I keep emphasizing small business tax breaks, so that people like Laura could have more job opportunities, so her employers would expand. And if she's working at McDonald's now, she can work her way up the ladder and move to a bigger restaurant or do some things that she may want to do. We want Laura to be upwardly mobile, because she obviously has the work ethic that we need, the kind of work ethic that's going to turn the economy around, and people like that need to be recognized. I think, Greta, that in Washington, D.C., the people who are underserved are the people who fall in between the income bracket of they make $50,000 to $200,000. People who have, and I'm talking household income, but it seems like there's a lot of programs out there for the poor. There's a lot of programs out there for the very wealthy. But the worker bees like Laura, and maybe it's not $50,000, maybe it's $25,000 to $200,000. But those are the people who we really need to say, look, these are the folks who are driving this economic train. What can we do to make their life easier? Can we give Laura, for example, health care tax credit so that
instead of just throwing the money to the banks, get something good going so we leave them a better place, even though it might be expensive? I mean, money, what is it, these flipping houses was a show on TV, and a lot of these houses that people lost were their third or fourth investment home. So, this boo-hoo-hoo, we're losing money. Well, we should lose money. We've been eating up the resources of the world for a long time, and we can't turn our back on the world.
Congressman, she's talking about infrastructure. There's a headline in today's New York Times, U.S. infrastructure is in dire straits, and it says that more than a quarter of the nation's bridges are structurally deficient or functionally obsolete. Leaky pipes lose an estimated 7 billion gallons of clean drinking water every day, and aging sewage systems send billions of gallons of untreated wastewater cascading into the nation's waterways each year. These are among the findings of a report released by the American Society of Civil Engineers, and they estimate that it would take $2.2 trillion investment from all levels of government over the next 5 years to bring it into a state of good repair.
And you know what, Greta? It's a nonpartisan issue, because whether you're living in Atlanta, Georgia, or Pennsylvania, or, you know, wherever you are, New Jersey, New York, California, we need to do something about our infrastructure. And what an opportunity we are missing on the stimulus package. $825 billion stimulus package, and I think only $48 billion goes to public works and infrastructure. $30 billion of that goes to highways, and about $3 billion goes to bridges. We're pouring money into things like the National Endowment for the Arts, $50 million, which doesn't create jobs. $3 billion for a wellness program, maybe a good idea, but it doesn't belong in the stimulus package. We're spending $6 billion on a broadband grant program to private companies. We're paying them to do what they were doing for free. We were loaning money to them, but now we're going to give them money. That money could be better directed to towns like hers in Pennsylvania to rebuild the highways and the bridges. Again, only 7% of the stimulus package goes to shovel-ready projects in the year 2009, and only 13% of the total spending goes to those type public works projects anyhow. So I think, in talking to Mr. Obama yesterday, this is one of our suggestions. Let's go back to the drawing board, put more money into infrastructure and job-creating, shovel-ready type projects, and cut out some of this unnecessary social spending, which maybe belongs in the normal budget. Maybe it does not belong in the normal budget, but that's where it should be debated, and Republicans and Democrats should be able to agree on that.
Hibbing, Minnesota, Independent Line.
I agree this should go back to the drawing board, and I'm a single mom. I had to raise my three kids, and I had to learn to budget. I had to learn to buy what I needed for the cheapest price. I had to manage basically, and I think.
Oh, caller, I'm so sorry about that. I pushed the wrong button. I apologize. Try to call back in, and we'll get you back on the air. We'll move on to Juliet, Illinois, Republican Line.
Hi, Congressman. I just want to salute you for coming out against this bill and the rest of the Republicans in Congress. Because this is ridiculous. I think there's money in there for ACORN and other groups, lawyers probably, and just everything down the checklist for the left. And I just want to salute you. And you guys can be like, you know, Gingrich was for Clinton, just the loyal opposition. And there's a time for bipartisanship, but you guys are doing a great job of saying, no, we're not going to be bipartisan on something that is just costing way too much money and isn't really going to work. And I just want to see some more maybe corporate tax cut, because it's very high in this country, and just more tax cuts, because, you know, money in the hands of businesses, is that's what creates jobs. And the government can't take them from the productive.
Thanks, Colette. Congressman, what did President Obama say to the Republican caucus yesterday about your tax cuts proposals? Any indication from him that they could make it into the final package?
Well, there was some encouragement there. He said that perhaps we could go back and expand some of our proposals on small business tax cuts, because he did share the philosophy that those could create some jobs. Now, he did not want to back away from the earned income tax credit and the $500 payroll tax credit that would apply to people who make under $75,000 a year. And he said this is good politics for me and it's good for the country, and that's his view. But I think he's just kind of taking a half a loaf when he does that, because just because you make over $75,000 a year, it doesn't mean that you're not struggling, and it doesn't mean that you would waste a tax cut. I think that if you really do it fairly, you'd have tax cuts across the board so that more people would get their money off the sideline and get them into the system. Buying new houses, new dryers, new washing machines, new cars. Good gosh, if everybody had a reduction in their taxes, there would be a lot of things that would happen in the economy, starting with housing and cars. That would turn the economy around almost as much as anything else.
Give us an idea of what that meeting was like yesterday with President Obama, and the fact that he came up to Capitol Hill which is not typical for a president to do. Usually he invites members of Congress to meet with him at the White House. But give us an idea of what it was like in that room yesterday.
I think it was an important meeting. I think it was a good meeting. But I hope it was just a first step. Because what I hope, Greta, that you can ask me a month from now, hey, tell me about that January meeting with President Obama, and I can look you in the eye and say, well, you know what we did? We set up working groups after that, and at his urging, Ms. Pelosi decided to set up some bipartisan dialogue, and we are now working as Democrats and Republicans together for the best interests of America, and it started because of Obama's meeting in January. Now, that's the answer I hope to give you in a month, but if in a month from now I say, yeah, he met with us, and that was about it, then we'll know that the meeting was just all about show and public relations, Al, and work with people like Heath Shuler from North Carolina, Democrat, and see what we can come up with together. And we've done some things on immigration reform. I've worked with Elliot Engel from New York City on alternative fuel research and things that I think we can agree on. We can find some things out there, and that would be a start. So I'm hoping that yesterday's meeting was more than just a discussion on the stimulus package, but a signal that it is a new day in Washington, D.C.
Laurel, Delaware, Democrats line.
Yes. Hello?
Good morning.
Good morning. I am a Democrat, registered Democrat, but I have a tendency to agree with the Republicans on this after watching Ms. Maloney. Kind of shows that they can't be trusted with trying to funnel money into the Acorn Group, and we know how they all supported them in the past election. Some of the callers suggested that, you know, if we don't want the stimulus, then don't take it. Well, and I agree with that, but we should not have to take our tax money and support it also. And that caller also blamed Bush for all the problems that we have now, and she keeps forgetting that the Democrats like Dobbs and Frank have been in charge since 2006. And where's that money all, you know, gone that they've already used? So it sounds to me like it's just more government jobs, which is just socialism to me, more socialism and more waste. And haste makes waste, like a caller says. And another thing, we have children, and I just feel that it's going to just put a big burden on them down the line. So I'm kind of agreeing with the Republicans on this one.
Go ahead.
Good. I want to say, I think he's right. I think we all need to maybe leave party labels behind and look at the stimulus package for what it is. I want to give you one example, which is a sacred cow, food stamps. We, in November, increased food stamps from $43 to $53 billion. Now, food stamps, and I'm on the committee, so I'm fairly familiar with it, it has an automatic enrollment and an automatic inflation adjustment. So if you're laid off today, there are food stamps for you, and they are adjusted to today's prices. That happens automatically, and it does so through the annual budget process. Yet, in the stimulus bill, we are increasing food stamps $19 billion. It's not needed based on the fact that we just increased it $10 billion a few months ago, and the enrollment in that period of time has not changed. But if it does change, it's automatically taken care of in the normal annual budget process. So what I worry about, Greta, is that now, instead of having a $53 billion floor on food stamps, we're going to add another $19 to it. So we're already up to $72 billion from food stamps. And that's going to be the minimum opening bid next year. And that's what happens with program after program. Whatever we spend, stimulus isn't just a one-shot deal. It becomes part of the permanent Washington bureaucracy. And that's where this caller is absolutely right in terms of what we're passing on to our children. It's more debt on top of debt. Again, $10.6 trillion in national debt.
Congressman, what role will you be playing in today's debate?
Well, I offered two amendments, and I did hear the previous congresswoman say that a lot of amendments were accepted. Actually, over 200 were proposed, 200 amendments to this, which shows you two things: how much people care, how much people are trying to work together to improve this bill, but it also shows you how much improvement needs to be done. But of the 200 that were submitted, only 11 were approved. Two of mine were rejected. One of mine took the $50 million out of the National Endowment to the Arts and put it in highway money so it would create more jobs, but that amendment was rejected. Now, I will still be speaking up. I did get an amendment that was accepted on the committee level that said none of the stimulus money will be used to pay illegal aliens to do jobs through electronic verification. Employers can make sure that their employees are lawful, and that had good bipartisan support. I want to make sure that stays in the bill, and I'm going to follow the debate and be on the House floor.
What did President Obama tell you and other Republicans yesterday about your opportunity to possibly change the legislation when it goes to conference between the House and the Senate?
Well, I think that he realizes, as we do, that while he was doing his transition, the House Democrats were busy working this stimulus program. And I think to some degree, it's more their program than it is his in terms of the House bill. Now, when it gets to the Senate, we all understand there will be changes. So probably he's not too optimistic about strong bipartisan support in the House today, but hopeful that could happen in the Senate. And in between now and then, what we will be doing, and Mr. Cantor and Mr. Camp from the Ways and Means Committee have already submitted some proposals that follow up yesterday's meeting. I will be sending Mr. Obama some proposals and some ideas that did not make the House mark. And so I hope between now and mid-February, when he wants this on his desk, I hope that we can have a lot more dialogue and there's a full engagement of Republicans and Democrats together to do what's right for America.
One last phone call here, Congressman. Noblesville, Indiana, Independent Line.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity to call. I have a glaring example of some of the things that I think we're doing wrong right now. I'm a real estate agent by trade. Recently, I was working with a private investor wanting to buy some of these toxic assets that we're trying to deal with. And he's in a position, has the money to do it. We found out through the lender that Fannie and Freddie rules for investors have recently changed, requiring 20 to 25% down payment to even purchase a property. Previously to the meltdown in housing, it was as low as 5%. Additionally, first-time home buyers are now required a minimum 3.5% down. Everybody realizes that the 100% financing created some problems, but if you're going to have 100% financing, it should be in times like these where we're reacting. You know, we've given all this money, billions of dollars, to the financial institutions. Now they're tightening lending to the point they're literally going to make the problem worse rather than correct it. I think everybody would agree that housing started all this. It is a big cause. Until we get that corrected and turned around, and it's going to be done by the private sector and private business and the market. It's not going to be done by government. These are things that I wrote my congressman yesterday on this issue, and I hope Representative Kingston here could maybe bring this forward. This is something that could be done right now.
Thanks, caller.
You know, I think that he's touching a good point, because one of the things the stimulus package in September, and I think one of the big mistakes is we didn't get the toxic assets off the shelf. They're still in the marketplace. They're still dragging down banks, and therefore they're dragging down the credit market. I think we've got to do something in the stimulus package to help put credit on the street for people who might be wanting to buy a house, and also do something directly to housing. Now, we passed a $7,500 tax credit that if you buy a house between now and June, then you do not have to pay that back. And so that's something that actually is helpful, but it might be a dollar short and a day late for housing. But I do think part of what we need to do on stimulus is cut out some of the spending, increase the public works, and increase or put in there something on housing and something on credit.
Congressman, in the Wall Street Journal this morning, they break it down how the money will be spent in this House bill, and it says about $60 billion for transportation, housing, and urban development. How much of that money will be for addressing the housing issue?
I'm not certain. I know part of that would be for the Farmers Home Administration that will help rural people buy houses, which might be, you know, like similar to Fannie Mae. It could be a source of last resort to get some money, but if it could help ease the credit crunch in the rural areas, it will be effective. A lot of that housing, though, and I haven't seen this article, Brett, I'll take a look at it, but some of this is for renovation of government buildings. For example, in the Ag Committee, of which I serve on appropriations, a lot of the money goes into building new agricultural research labs and USDA facilities, but it's classified as housing.